Why don't most of us have the courage to fail? You know, most of us think we have the guts, but do we really? When preparing this talk, I experienced a lot of anxiety. I worried, what if I don't have anything of value to say? What if it's not good enough? Do I really want to get up in front of 1,000 people and thousands online and talk about failure? My failures? Worst of all, what if I fail right here? Turns out that many of the TEDx speakers today had anxiety about their talk. And many of them have accomplished so much, but yet they still had that anxiety. There was some comfort in knowing that I wasn't alone. So how did I deal with my anxiety? First, I blamed myself for accepting the invitation. I thought of bowing out. Then I blamed the person who invited me. I was mad I said yes. Just a few minutes ago, I was eyeing the backstage door for a quick exit. Really? Why am I so scared? I'm so scared because of the emotional risk and vulnerability I knew I'd have to give for this talk. But you know what occurred to me? Wouldn't it be ironic if I were to fail at my failure talk? Would it be a success if I showed an example of failure or a failure? You see, we really can't talk about icons, geniuses, and mavericks unless we talk about failure. Because all of them accomplished a lot of things, but they went through a lot of failure to get there. In fact, these Edison-style light bulbs here from the ceiling remind us one of the biggest strings of failures in innovation, the birth of the light bulb. Edison failed over and over. How many of you would fail 10,000 times to succeed? Did Edison think of his experiments as unsuccessful outcomes or as failures? Although we intellectually understand that failure is part of the process to succeed, that's the easy part. The emotional part of failure is the hard part. And why is that? Because the emotional stuff is messy. However, this is where the real opportunity exists to help people fail with more ease. What if you could embrace failure, race towards it, so you could succeed faster? Yes, I said race towards it so you could succeed faster. But how do we embrace this and run towards failure? You see, I can talk about this because I'm an expert in failure. I've failed in relationships, in business, in investing, in teaching. I might fail here today. Actually, I already did. I'm just always one small misstep from failure. In fact, I am fail ready. Sounds like an action figure, doesn't it? I thought that joke might fail. With a computer science degree and never have attended one business class, at age 24, with $250, I started a computer consulting firm. I tell my students I've made every mistake in small business. Not most, every mistake. I used credit cards to make payroll. I hired too quickly. I fired too slowly. Grew too aggressively. The list goes on and on. At one point when cash flow was really bad, and we were losing money, my board said I should probably shut it down. That was a low point. Felt completely alone. Felt like a loser. However, after 17 years of ups and downs, I was finally able to build that company up and sell it to a multi-billion-dollar engineering firm in 1999. Around that time, I started angel investing, which is investing in startup companies. I've failed plenty of times at investing. I also went back to school to get a PhD because I wanted to teach, one of my passions. When I was close to graduating, one of my former board members from my company, who was also a university professor, said, I should share my failures with students. He said, that's the value I have to offer. I didn't immediately embrace this. Share my failures? But I'm going to be a university professor, and I'm going to help students succeed. How naive. This stuck in my mind. My best value was how much I failed. How many of you have failed? Raise your hands. Hey, we're taking photos. Anyone not with their hand up? We have a team of psychologists outside, and we're going to talk to you. That's right. I want to see all those hands up. Thank you. Did you learn anything? I have. And I try to make it worth something beyond me. Each semester, I tell my students to write a failure resume. On the left side, they write all their failures, left column. On the right column, they write all the things they learned from those failures. And I try to get them to learn that failure equals learning. In the first day of class every semester, I show them videos about failure, and I talk about failure with much excitement. They look at me strangely. In fact, they look at me strangely all semester, but that's a whole different talk. To help you understand this, it might be helpful for you to think about a past failure right now. How does it feel? Probably not too good. And herein lies what holds us back. What holds us back is how we feel. How we feel is based on what we think this failure means about us. If we thought it meant we were good or smart or successful, we'd feel good. However, this is typically not what happens. Sometimes we feel bad, shame, dumb, or a number of other negative feelings. You know, maybe we should have known better. Maybe we could have been smarter. Maybe we could have worked harder. Often when we're in this place, we're anxious and lonely. For many of us, we grew up learning failure equals bad. However, some of us learn that failure equals bad, but giving up is much, much worse. This need to persist helps some of us push through the anxiety to a successful outcome. But what is this underlying anxiety connected to? We can trace this anxiety back to a psychological term called faulty core beliefs. These are intense fears that develop as we grow up. They tend to be things like fear of isolation, fear of aloneness, which translates to I'll be alone in the world, I'm unlovable, maybe a fear of inadequacy, or fear of failure, which translates to I'm inadequate, I'm not enough, I've let you down. These faulty core beliefs happen at a very low level, thus making the connection, it's not often very obvious. So you have to really work to understand how things typically reduce down to these few faulty core beliefs. However, failure triggers the fear that our faulty core beliefs are true. When this triggers, anxiety causes a survival reaction of flight, fight, or freeze. Triggering these faulty core beliefs holds us back, keeps us anxious. As humans, we often avoid anxiety and negative feelings. This is why when we say things to ourselves like, oh, I shouldn't feel this way, or I need to be stronger, or I need to stay calm, it really doesn't help. These sayings are dealing with the symptoms, not the root of the problem. In addition, we feel vulnerable. Anxiety, faulty core beliefs, feeling vulnerable, is there any surprise that we avoid failure, even though intellectually we know it's part of the process of success? Brene Brown at a past TED Talk said it best. So let me go on the record and say, vulnerability is the birthplace of innovation, creativity, and change. To create is to make something that has never existed before. There's nothing more vulnerable than that. Change is all about vulnerability. Lastly, in the midst of failure, we are afraid of what others think. Are we excited to share those failures? Probably not. Probably reluctant. Well, why can't we be proud of failures? Because we care about what others think about us. And that's where icons, geniuses, and mavericks are different. Very different. Often they don't care what others think. They don't care what failure means about them. They are indifferent for the most part. They have courage. They have courage to fail. Courage to pursue their dream. They are so focused on their goal that they don't let others control their thoughts. Don't let others control your thoughts and thus your success. Did Edison look at unsuccessful outcomes as failures? Not likely. My guess is that the anxiety he had regarding his failures was simply trumped by the need to persist and succeed. He simply recognized he did not attain the outcome desired and moved on to the next experiment. He didn't let his failure affect his identity. To him, those were two separate things, or what psychologists called differentiation. So here's another difference with icons, geniuses, and mavericks. They persist. Their psychological wiring pushes them past the uncomfortable feelings of failure due to the need to succeed. Most of us likely see failures as obstacles we can't quite overcome. However, they see them as minor speed bumps or even a motivation to try again and move on. Now, often we look at others who fail and we have compassion. Rarely do we show that compassion for ourselves. Often we admire them for taking a risk. Why? Because they had the courage. So let's go back to what my former board member said. Share your failures with your students. That's the value you have to offer. My experience has been that the best learning in the classroom happens when we discuss failures rather than successes. The speakers at the students find most impactful are those who are open, vulnerable, and discuss their failures. You know, to students and younger entrepreneurs, I appear successful. I really don't see myself as successful because I know all the mistakes and all the failures I made. Some might think I built a successful company from $250 and sold it. But what do I think? Bill Gates started his company the same year I did, and the results are dramatically different. Some might say, hey, you went back to graduate school at 41, completely changed your career path, got 3 graduate degrees. What do I think? My research is not good enough. Some might think that you had a successful term as the chairman of the largest angel group in the world. I feel like I didn't accomplish enough as chairman. What's wrong with this thinking? I'm only focusing on what I failed at, not what I accomplished. Often when we reflect, we look at our failures while others see our successes. Many of my students think I'm successful because they've only seen the result. They weren't there when I had to lay people off because I made mistakes in how I grew the company. They weren't there when I thought the bank was going to call my bank loan and shut me down. They weren't there for all my failures and mistakes. So after years of working with entrepreneurs and students, I started to notice when I discussed these failures and the speakers I brought in the class discussed failures, that not only did the learning increase, not only were the students more engaged, but barriers started to break down. The more they saw me as someone who had made mistakes, the more the distance between them and myself reduced. And the more that distance reduced, the more connection there was, and the more it felt to me, at least, the more they felt success was attainable. This is when I realized I had been stingy sharing my failures. Although I'd shared many, I'd not been aggressive enough in sharing more. I had been selfish, letting my own discomfort getting in the way of helping others. Or another way to say this is I failed at sharing failure. So my message to you is don't be greedy with your failure. Share it. Share it widely, share it often. Share it today. Don't fail at sharing your failure like I did. Now, in the classroom to a student, anyone over 40 or even close to 40 is a nearly dead. Therefore, I'm a nearly dead. So I have a special message to the nearly deads in the audience and those people who have been 39 for more than once. You are the biggest failures. You have the most to give. It's your responsibility to share your failures. Don't be greedy. Don't be selfish. Share them so others can succeed. Sharing failure breaks down barriers and it helps others learn. It helps others succeed. Oh, and you 20 and 30-somethings? Start sharing your failures with your peers now. No reason to wait to be a nearly dead. You can help each other right now. Now, is there anything else in it for you besides helping others? I think there is. By sharing your failures, you give purpose to them. What was once maybe an embarrassment becomes the start of your own healing process and the source of helping others. It starts the path to embracing them. Think back to one of your personal failures again. Did it feel lonely? Did you ever watch friends discuss a problem and then see them realize that they were struggling with the same issue? How does it feel when you realize you're not the only one with a particular problem? Often it feels comforting, just like it did for me earlier. Once you start sharing and board the failure train, you'll find it packed. And when you look around, you'll find most of your friends on it. So let's get back to us nearly deads. We nearly deads need to have the courage to help others. Let's talk about courage. We often think of courage as that scene in Braveheart where Mel Gibson leads thousands of men into battle. But a more important type of courage might be the courage to challenge self, confront your failures, and have the strength to share them and move on. Because in reality, past failures become your strength, build experience, knowledge, and wisdom. So share your failures. It will help you help others succeed. So my words are to you, fail, share, help yourself, help others succeed. Thank you.